Hi students, this is a new topic, thermodynamics. Already we studied about dynamics in the first part of our textbook as motion in a straight line, motion on a plane, loss of motion, work energy power. These are all comes under mechanics. Dynamics is the study of bodies which are under motion plus the cause of motion. So the cause of motion is nothing but force. Now here, this is not a mechanical dynamics, this is a thermodynamics. Thermo means heat. Whenever a body moves due to the applied mechanical force, then we will study the motion of that body as a dynamics. If a body moves due to the application of thermal energy or heat energy, then the study of the motion of that body is named as a thermodynamics. For example, the best example for this one is a steam engine or this car, scooter, bus. So all these are, even aeroplane, they are using heat energy to produce the motion in those bodies. So what is this thermodynamics? Conversion of heat energy into mechanical energy and vice versa is known as thermodynamics. Heat energy into mechanical energy is known as thermodynamics. So in this thermodynamics, we can convert this heat into the useful work. That mechanical energy is nothing but work. So by using this heat energy, we can do some work. By doing this work, these bodies can move along a straight line or in a circle path, whatever may be, but they will get the motion. So we can convert heat into work into heat, which is easy. So that is my question. If you do some work, we can produce heat energy. Best example is rubbing two hands against each other. As we are doing work against the friction between these two hands. So friction is the force and we are displacing this hand. So we know that work done is equal to force into displacement. So here we are doing work against the friction. So converting work into heat is easy. Whereas converting heat into work is a little bit difficult. So here the best example is rubbing hands against each other, where the friction is doing, we are doing some work against the friction, which converts into heat energy. Now, first we should know some terms that are related to the thermodynamics. First one, thermodynamic system. So what is this thermodynamic system? A collection of materials or molecules or the particles. So if you collect similar particles, so this is called a system. We call it as thermodynamic system. So definition is collection of particles which is undergoing changes in pressure, volume, temperature, heat, internal energy is known as a thermodynamic system. Suppose if you take a gas, so I took some gas here in a container. The initial pressure is P1, initial volume V1, temperature T1. By supplying some heat energy, so if I supply some heat energy here, so I am heating this gas, then pressure increases to P2, volume changes to V2, temperature changes to T2. So whenever this pressure or volume or temperature changes, as these molecules initially they are moving slowly, by receiving heat energy, their kinetic energy will increase. Due to increase in kinetic energy, the temperature also increases. As the temperature increases, we can say the internal energy of the system also increases. We will learn about internal energy in this lesson in detail. So here pressure is changing, volume is changing, temperature is changing, we are supplying some heat energy to this one. Previously heat inside this gas is less, I supplied some more heat, so heat is changing and internal energy is changing. So even if any one quantity changes in this one, then we can say it is a thermodynamic system. So it is a collection of particles or materials which is undergoing changes in pressure, volume, temperature, heat or internal energy. Here we call it as, these are known as thermodynamic variables. The variables that varies, the properties or the quantities that varies in a process are known as thermodynamic variables. Now, thermodynamic system can be divided into three types. The first one is closed system. This is open system. This is isolated system. Open and isolated. In open system, it is open, so both energy as well as mass exchanges between system and the surroundings. Open system, closed system, only energy exchange takes place. Here, no energy exchange takes place, no mass is exchanged between system and surroundings. But what is this term surroundings? Surroundings. Surroundings are here in this example. I am studying about the properties of, that is thermodynamic properties of the system. That is the other pressure, volume, temperature, internal energy. So I am studying about this one. So this gas, let us say this is oxygen gas, O2. So this oxygen gas within this boundary is known as a system. Whereas this container and the air surrounding this one are known as surroundings. So what are surroundings? Anything or any material or particles other than system under study. Under study are known as surroundings. So here, if you take one example here, closed system. So let me take a closed chamber here, which consists of some gas here. So this is the gas within this chamber. In this, if you heat this gas, if you supply some heat energy, what happens? First of all, the system receives heat energy from the surroundings, because this is the surroundings and this is the system here. So from the surroundings, heat enters into the system. So that means heat exchange takes place between system and surroundings, then energy exchange takes place. And here, by heating this one, the mass of the particles never changes. Pressure of the gas will change, volume changes, temperature changes, heat energy, internal, everything change. But the mass never changes. Mass cannot come out. Mass exchange, either the air which is present here cannot enter into the system, or the gas which is inside this container cannot come out. That means here only energy will exchange. That is called a closed system. What is open system? Suppose if you open this one, now if you heat it, what happens? Energy exchange takes place between this and this. Heat enters from this flame or fire to this system. And heat from this system also enters into the surroundings, that is air, surrounding air. So here, energy exchange takes place between system and the surroundings, and also mass, because as we are heating this gas, gas will try to escape from this one. So the mass of the gas inside this one, initially let us say 1 kg, after heating it may become 0.8 kg. that means 0.2 kg of the gas escaped from this one. So both energy and mass are exchanged between the system and surroundings, then it is called open system. And then isolated system. System in which neither heat nor mass exchanged is known as isolated system. If we consider the system and surroundings, just like one container here, and in this I took some gas So this is the gas, these are the gas molecules. So these molecules are known as a system. And what is the surroundings? Surroundings means this one is the surrounding here. The fire that we are giving is surrounding. The air present surrounding this one is surroundings. But you can say this is the system here. This is the system. So we are studying about the properties of this gas. Any system is any material, collection of material which is under study is known as system. System is nothing but collection of materials, collection of particles under study. So we are studying about the thermodynamic properties of this collection of materials, which is known as system. Surrounding means other than system. Anything other than system is called surroundings. Now, between this surroundings and this system, there is a gap or there is some wall, there are some walls here. So these walls are separating the system and the surroundings. So the line or the boundary that divides the system and the surroundings, so we call it as wall. And these walls are divided into two types. The boundary that divides the system and surroundings is called wall. Here we have diathermic wall and adiabatic wall. So we have two types of walls, diathermic and adiabatic walls. What are these diathermic walls and adiabatic walls? Adiabatic walls means heat exchange does not take place between the system and surroundings. So the wall in which heat exchange does not take place. Heat exchange does not take place and that wall is called adiabatic wall. What is diathermic wall? The wall through which heat exchange takes place easily is known as a diathermic wall. Heat exchange takes place through a wall. Those walls are known as a diathermic wall. Now, this adiabatic wall can also be named as insulating wall. Insulating wall means it will not allow the heat to flow from here to here or here to here. Best example, if you take a thermoplast, if you keep some tea inside the thermoplast, heat exchange will not take place between the tea as well as the surroundings. So the wall of the thermoplast is adiabatic, or also called, we call it as insulating wall. And the diathermic wall, as it is conducting heat from the system to surroundings or surrounding system, it is also called a conducting wall. Now, after that, now we are going to learn about zeroth law of thermodynamics. So what is this zeroth law of thermodynamics? In thermodynamics, the first law was given, then second law was given. After that, they found one more law which is important, more important than the first law and second law. That's why generally we call it as first law and second law. As the first law and second law was given before this law, but the importance of this law is great when compared to the other two laws. That's why it is called zeroth law. So what is this zeroth law? Before learning about this zeroth law, first of all we should know what is this thermal equilibrium. In system of particles and rotation motion, we studied about mechanical equilibrium. A system is said to be in mechanical equilibrium if it is under translatory equilibrium as well as rotatory equilibrium. Now, if I want to keep this body on my hand, the weight of this pen is acting my hand on my hand. Hand is applying equal and opposite force on this one. This is called normal reaction. The sum of these two forces which are acting equal and opposite will become zero. So it is said to be in translatory equilibrium. Similarly, if I am rotating this one, so it is rotating here, I can rotate this one by applying a torque here. But here, without applying any torque, body remains in a rotational equilibrium. So the body is said to be mechanical equilibrium if it is in thermal, if it is in translatory equilibrium as well as rotational equilibrium, then the system is said to be in mechanical equilibrium. But here, this is not mechanical equilibrium, this is a thermal equilibrium. Now, what is this thermal equilibrium? If you keep two bodies in contact, this is body A and this is body B. So I took two bodies which are kept in contact with each other. This is body B. When these two are kept in contact with each other, for example, let me give some values. Temperature of this one is 30 degrees Celsius, first body. Temperature of this one is 100 degrees Celsius. Then what happens? We know that heat is a form of energy that always flows from high temperature to low temperature. Here, heat flows from body B to body A. The flow of this heat or heat exchange or transfer of heat takes place between B to A till the both bodies will get equal temperature. If these two are similar bodies, identical bodies made of same material having same dimensions, then what happens? This is 100, this is 30. So average of this one is 100 plus 30 by 2, 130 by 2. So this body will get 65 degrees Celsius. Even this body will get 65 degrees Celsius. That means the temperature of this body before contact was 100. So slowly it reduces to 65. That means the temperature of this body reduced by 100 minus 35, which is equal to 35. This temperature of this body increases by 35. So finally, temperature of A initially was 30, temperature of B initially was 100. So after some time, temperature of A will become 65, temperature of B also becomes 65. When these two temperatures are equal, then the heat transfer will be stopped between these two. Whenever two bodies are in contact with each other at two different temperatures, if there is no flow of heat between these two bodies, then these two bodies are said to be in thermal equilibrium. So what is the condition for thermal equilibrium? Or what is the definition of thermal equilibrium? Two bodies are said to be in thermal equilibrium in contact if no heat exchange takes place between those two bodies. So here I am going to write, thermal equilibrium is the condition in which a heat transfer or heat exchange will not take place between two bodies in contact. When two or more bodies are in contact with each other, if no heat exchange takes place between them, then they are said to be in thermal equilibrium. Zeroth law. So what is the zeroth law? Here, if you take two different bodies, this is body A and this is body B, these two are two different bodies which are not in contact with each other, but another body was placed with A. Let me take this body C here, which is in contact with A, and even body C is also in contact with C, and it is found that A and C are in thermal equilibrium. A and C are in thermal equilibrium. B and C are in thermal equilibrium. Then we can say both A and B are also in thermal equilibrium. That means these two are at same temperature and no flow heat is flowing between these two. If the same body is kept here, these two also thermal equilibrium, no heat is taking, no heat transfer taking place between these two. Then these two also are said to be in thermal equilibrium. So this is the zeroth law of thermodynamics. So how to define zeroth law of thermodynamics? If two bodies are in thermal equilibrium with a third body separately, because these three are not connected together or not in contact with each other. First, A and C are kept in contact with each other, both are in thermal equilibrium. Now C is placed here and B and C are also in thermal equilibrium. That means compulsory A and B should be in thermal equilibrium. So if two bodies are in thermal equilibrium with a third body separately, then those two bodies are also said to be in thermal equilibrium. It is just like in mathematics, while solving some problems, we take if x is equal to y and x is equal to z. Let us say you got two equations, x is equal to y and x is equal to z. So from this two we can write y is equal to z. So this is how you can write these, we are using this in algebra. Similarly here, what is the meaning of this one? As these two are in thermal equilibrium, no heat exchange between these two, so temperature of A must be equal to temperature of C. Similarly, when these two are in thermal equilibrium with each other, temperature of B is equal to temperature of C. So we have two equations now, similar to these two, so temperature of A is equal to temperature of C. Temperature of B is equal to temperature of C. So when this condition is satisfied, we can say temperature of A is equal to temperature of B. The same thing we are writing here, zeroth law of thermodynamics. If two bodies are in thermal equilibrium with a third body separately, then these two bodies are also said to be in thermal equilibrium, even though they are not in contact. Here these two are in contact, these two are in contact, these two are not in contact, but they are said to be in thermal equilibrium. Why? Because TA is equal to TC, TB is equal to TC, then TA is equal to TB. So what is the use of this thermodynamics? What is the importance of this thermodynamics, zeroth law? The zeroth law states that heat exchange takes place between two bodies whenever there is a temperature difference or the body should not be in thermal equilibrium. So that is the final conclusion here. So the concept of temperature is explained by this zeroth law. So this gives the concept of temperature or the concept of heat flow. So heat flows between two bodies if they are not in thermal equilibrium. If two bodies kept in contact with each other attains that thermal equilibrium, then no heat exchange takes place between these two bodies. Till they are not in thermal equilibrium, as they are not in thermal equilibrium, heat flows between those two bodies. Once they achieve this thermal equilibrium, heat never flows from one body to another body. Why? Because in thermal equilibrium, both bodies will be in same temperature, and for that heat to flow from one body to another body, there must be some temperature difference. So if delta T, that is the temperature difference between these two bodies, is equal to zero, the amount of heat flowing is also equal to zero. If delta T is not equal to zero, that means if it is a number, non-zero value, then heat flows from one body to another body, that is always from body at high temperature to body at low temperature. Here, from the zeroth law of thermodynamics, we can say that temperature is the quantity that decides the flow of heat. So we know that water always flows from higher altitude to lower altitude without any aid, that is without any mechanical aid or electrical aid or pump. Similarly, gas always flows from high pressure to low pressure. Similarly, heat flows from high temperature body to low temperature body. So this is the main concept of this zeroth law of thermodynamics. So zeroth law of thermodynamics explains the concept of temperature, and temperature will decide the flow of heat between two bodies. First law of thermodynamics. This law states that the total heat energy supplied to a system is utilized to do some work. So whenever some work is done on a system, so the total heat supplied to a system, so this is dq, because already whenever a system is taken, it will have some heat energy. So we are adding some more heat energy. The quantity of heat added is denoted with the letter dq. This is equal to change in internal energy of the system plus the work done on the system. Before this also, the molecules are moving randomly in zigzag path in all possible directions. So that as they are moving, they are applying some force on the other molecules, the molecules are doing some work. But I am talking about the external work done on the system. So what is this dQ, the heat energy supplied to the system? What is dU, that is change in internal energy? So whenever a system is taken in a closed chamber, so this is a gas, this gas will not be at rest. The gas molecules always moves from one place to another place in all possible directions. Generally we call this as a zigzag motion, or also called a random motion. So these molecules will be under continuous motion. So when these molecules are under continuous motion, so they have two types of energies. One is kinetic energy, the other one is potential energy. So what is the total energy of the system? Total energy of this system before supplying heat. So this is equal to sum of kinetic energy plus potential energy. So sum of these two energies, we call it as a internal energy of the system. We denote with the letter U. This is the symbol used to indicate the internal energy, that is the total energy of the system. This is the sum of Ke plus PE. What is this kinetic energy? We know that the energy possessed by a particle due to its motion is called kinetic energy. As these molecules are moving in all possible directions, the system will have kinetic energy. In this, each and in a gas, it will have three types of motions, the three possible motions. What are these three possible motions? One is a translatory motion. Second one, rotatory motion. Third one, vibrational motion. So the total kinetic energy is sum of three types of kinetic energies. So this is divided into three types of kinetic energies. One is translatory kinetic energy. So Ke translatory, Ke rotatory, Ke vibrational motion. So these are the three types of motions. So by adding the kinetic energy of these molecules due to translatory, that is moving along a straight line, and as they are moving from one place to another place, sometimes they may rotate about their own axis, and some molecules or particles may vibrate about their mean position. So all these three types of motions are possible. That's why kinetic energy can be divided into three types. And then what is this potential energy? Potential energy is the energy possessed by its height, or not only height, if it is a gravitational potential energy, we need to consider this as a energy possessed by a particles due to height. But here, due to configuration, that is arrangement of these molecules, or due to position of these molecules, or due to the phase of these molecules or state of these molecules. Here position can be written as height also, but this will come only in case of the gravitational potential energy. We are not going to consider the gravitational potential energy here, because all the molecules are in random motion and potential energy will be less. And the second one, configuration. Whenever two bodies in contact with each other, they possess action reaction pairs. But when they are moving in two different directions, to arrange these two molecules, we need to do some work. Suppose if you want to keep two bricks here, to bring the first brick, I need to do some work. So I kept the first brick here. This is the first brick. Now I want to bring another brick here. To bring the second brick here, I need to do some more work. So the total work done by me to arrange these two bricks in this position is called the gravitational potential energy, because I am doing work against the gravity. So I am lifting the brick from the ground to here. So I kept one here and I brought one more here. So I am doing work against the gravity. So this is the energy possessed by this system in this configuration or in this position and this arrangement is called gravitational potential energy. But here, we will not consider this configuration, we will not consider this position, we will consider the phase of this one. Whenever a system is taken, here I took one gas. When gas remains as gas, the potential energy never changes. So what is the change in potential energy? This is change in potential energy, which is equal to change in kinetic energy plus change in potential energy. So here, whenever a gas is in a particular state, whenever a substance is in a particular state, now if you take a solid, when the solid remains as solid, its change in potential energy always zero. When the liquid is in, when a substance is in the liquid state, change in potential energy in that state, because whenever phase changes, state changes, potential energy changes. So for a given gas, as it is gas, when it is in the gaseous state, the potential energy remains same. That's why generally change in potential energy will be taken as change in kinetic energy only. Why? Because it will not be considered. And one more point that you have to remember, whenever two particles attract with each other, they possess potential energy. Whenever two particles repulse with each other also, these two repulse with each other also, then also they possess a potential energy. But it is found that the intermolecular force of attraction or repulsion between the gas molecules is negligible. So I am going to write this point here. The intermolecular force of attraction between gas molecules is found to be nearly zero. When there is no intermolecular force of attraction between gas molecules, then what we can write, the potential energy will be zero. Why? Because whenever there is attraction or repulsion, then only the system will possess the potential energy. Here, the change in potential energy should be considered as change in kinetic energy only. Why? Because change in potential energy is zero. Reasons are, first one, with the phase is not changing, phase remains constant. Second one, intermolecular or interatomic attraction or repulsion is negligible, almost zero. That's why potential energy, change in potential energy is zero. Now, in this case, the first law states that the total heat supplied to a system is utilized to increase the internal energy and to do some external work. So, I am going to write the statement now. Total heat energy supplied to a system utilized to increase internal energy. First one, so this heat supply is utilized to increase the internal energy and to plus, or you can write and to do external work. So here we discussed about the internal energy, now we will discuss about the external work. The change in internal energy is the, it indicates the increase or decrease in temperature. Whenever DU is positive, that means if internal energy increases, generally temperature of the system is said to be increased. If internal energy of a system decreased, so if it is negative or if it decreases, so when the internal energy decreases means the kinetic energy decreased, temperature decreases. So here internal energy also linked with KE. So KE decreases, here KE is said to be increased. Now we will discuss about this work done. What is this work done? How to define this work done? In first part of our textbook, we write work done is the dot product of force and displacement. So we studied this in lower classes also. Now, if a gas is given, now how to find the work done on the gas or by the gas? Now, you take one piston here. This is a piston and this is a cylinder. So in this cylinder, A piston is fitted such that it can move freely without friction through these walls of this cylinder. Now, if you press this one, if you apply some force on this one, we can compress the gas. That means we are doing work on the gas. Remember this one, this is the, when we are moving this piston downwards, so we are applying force on the gas molecules, then volume decreases, that means it will be compressed. So whenever gas is compressed, we can say work is done on the gas. Work is done on the gas. Similarly, if you heat this system, you keep this piston like this, and if you supply some heat energy here, then whenever some heat is supplied to a system, what happens? The heat received by this gas will be received by this gas, and gas molecules will get more kinetic energy. So internal energy will increase. Due to this, slowly it will push the piston outwards. So piston moves upwards. So previously force is acting on the gas molecule. Now force exerted by the gas molecules on the piston. Due to this, the volume of the gas will increases. Volume increases. Gas is said to be expanded. Due to this, we can say work is done by the gas, not on the gas. In this case, the gas molecules are doing some work on the piston, and the gas molecules are pushing the piston outwards. So work done by the gas. Why? Because this is most important term here. Whenever work is done by the gas, work is said to be positive. Work is done on the gas, work is said to be negative. So this is the most important point that you have to remember in this derivation. So here dW is negative, whereas here dW is positive. Now, how to find this dW? So here, when the gas is expanding, it pushing this piston slowly outwards like this. When it is pushing it outwards, the work is said to be done by the gas. So here, if the piston moves very slowly here, the pressure of the gas is almost constant. Now, I am going to use this same expression here. Work done is the product of displacement and force. So I am going to take W is equal Fs. If it is a small displacement, we can write a small work done here. Now, I am taking the same cylinder and piston arrangement. Let the volume of this gas is V initially. So initial volume V1 is equal to V. So when heat is supplied to this one, gas molecule expand and pushes the piston outwards. The final volume is given by V plus delta V. This is the increase in volume of this gas, and we denote with the V2. Now, here I am going to write dW is equal, how to find the force exerted by this gas on the piston. We know that the thermodynamic variables are pressure, volume, temperature. Pressure is given by force by area. So force is the pressure into area. So in place of force, you can write pressure into area into ds, where A is the area of cross section of the cylinder or the piston. So dW is given by pressure into area into ds, which is equal to dW is equal to pressure into change in volume. So this is the expression to find out the work done by the gas or on the gas. Here P is the constant pressure of this gas at which it is pushing this piston outwards, or at which the piston is pushing the gas inwards. Now, if you integrate this one on both sides, you will get the total work done. So to find out the total work done, we need to integrate this one on both sides. So integral dW will become W, which is equal to integral P dV, P into dV, with limits V1 and V2. So this is called integral symbol, integration. Integration means, already we discussed this in motion, straight line. Sum of similar quantities. So just like this is adding similar quantities, so addition only. So this is the similar to that is letter S here, sum of this one, but we should call it as integral of. So this is integral of. If you know the small work done by the gas, so for this gas to expand from here to here, the small work done is, let us say, dW1. And to push this one little bit more, dW2, little bit more, dW3, little bit more, dW4, and like this. So what is the total work done? The total work done is going by dW1 plus dW2 plus dW3 and so on dWn. So this total work done is going by adding all the similar quantities here. We are adding only works here. So integral of dW. So this is how we can use this symbol. Integral means sum of all the similar quantities. So this is integral of dW.